All the greatness of you. yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Jesus. Let's give it one more time. Let's give a hand of praise to our God. Hallelujah. Join with me together. Yes. Let's give a hand of praise to our Lord, our Savior. Hallelujah, Jesus. Because the name of Jesus, the powerful name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Yes, that name, that wonderful name, that beautiful name, the name of Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord, we give it all back to you, Lord. The glory, the honor, and the praises to your name. Your fo ya to levi inga o le fa manu o le fa ne tanga ya te olo ma te utua o no o Yesu ma te utalo ma te wole malau utua I ala langa mai la ingo le tua. Amen, amen, and amen. Look, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's give a round of applause one more time for Pastor Oti and Trish Oti and the Divine Ministry and the worship team. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Are you excited tonight? Amen. Or if you feel nafi yafi. Hallelujah. 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 And before we collect our offering, can I ask our Samoa Revival Church is to get ready for your item. You're opening our performances tonight after our offering. Turn to the person next to you and tell her, it's offering time. We're still in our worship. Amen. This is part of our worship tonight. Amen. And offering is also, amen, a cheerful thing that we have to give. Amen. Do, amen. It's a cheerful thing that we have to do. Amen. Give it out of your heart. Amen. Give, and it will be given to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. Mai fa sa fa sa mo ia u tau fo ia tu e fo ina mai ai ia te u tau e fo ina mai ai no ta tau lava ia pulpulu le fo le lei e le lomi malulu ina e tumu ma solo i tua wa o le fo tau te fo ina tu e fo ina mai ia te u tau. Amen. Give and it shall be given back to you. When you give, amen, God will give it back to you. Amen. I for I et for I my for ele to ya to. Amen. My tell just by your ole tele ana lulu e tele ana ele tele ana sai to lulu tel for ya na sele sele. Amen. The more you give, amen, the more you receive. Hallelujah. La ta to tsalo sa uni ta pena la for il ne ya fi. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your son Jesus. Because this is the result of what you have done for us on that cross. You have given your son first to us. Now in response, we're giving it back to you as an offering, Father, to show our appreciation of what you have done for us. Yes, Lord, in our lives, in our family, in our children, Lord. And we give it all back to you. Lord, I pray that you will bless your people tonight as they will give cheerfully unto you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And every saint say, amen. Let's welcome our first item on stage. Let's give up for Samoan Revival youth from Central Side. Amen. With their item. Hallelujah. To avis la ngā pati nai fa fa loa iai. Le tātou au po le tupulanga televou. Mai le Samoan Revival Church I nei le Central Side.
Besa pati tasina le favi fatele le vinga le tua. Mo mona fatelo le wa yo le sauninga le nei tua le fiafi susunga fa fenga le But yeah, my last seat at all. So near Fiafi, La Sauni Mato Otolavo, Samuel Vava Church, a facing a civil pupu, a fia lima for living on the tour.
A few years ago, we started social media, and you have all of these little abbreviations. One of them is OMG. Somebody say OMG. And you use that when something is just mind-blowing, or it's something you never thought of, or something you just, it's hard to wrap your mind around. But that something is Jesus. I just, every time you think you can grasp the fullness of who he is, he does something else to blow your mind. And it makes you go, oh my God, look what you've done. Anybody just been in that place where God just does something exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think, and it makes you go, OMG, look what you have done. Right where you are, I just need you to start thinking about those things that God has done in your life that you couldn't expect, that you couldn't ask for, that you did not know to pray for. And God does it just in the nick of time. And you just go, oh my God, look what you've done. Oh my God.
Capture all you show me. I'll never sing my love for you. Oh, I've tasted. I'll tell the world of what I've tasted. Your goodness towards me won't be wasted. Never sing my love for you. Crumble, silence the roaring thunder.
Hallelujah. To ave so to long patch vi ia ile tua ile nei fiafi. Pati pati mai mo la tema matango fie. Al Samo Revival Church my Ipswich. Introducing our second performance for tonight. Let's welcome Pastor Faresa and the team Extreme from the south side with a freak round of applause. Hallelujah.
God is good all the time. Yeah, we had to an fiafi maulunga non vienga, junga fenganga molato for tua, or aleo yes farm talanga, no no fat sala. We yellow sui to fatalo for turning fiafi. Team Extreme is a team of, we under the covering of YWAM, a youth with a mission, and we travel all over the world and share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Using our song and our dance, that we believe the God Almighty, the creator of the universe, our Father above, that he created our song and our dance to glorify his name. So it's just a tool that God has given to us to send the message and deliver the message of Jesus Christ. So we're going to start because of our time. So we're going to, our first dance, we're going to take you to the beautiful island of Hawaii. Everybody say, aloha!
Aloha!
You can do better than that. Aloha!
Aloha!
Aloha in the island of Hawaii means hello, goodbye, and much, much more. The true meaning of the true definition of this word, alo means coming to the presence of ha, the breath of life. So when you say aloha to somebody, it means you release life to one another. Turn to somebody and say, aloha. Shake somebody's hand. All right, next time you ask for $20. E kua mawa o mai kaipu. E tulele o nani ka makua mau. mai, kai puele koe mai. Our dance tonight is speaking about the Creator. There's no church, there's no organization that died for you and I. Only Jesus that hang on the cross and he rose again. Ladies and gentlemen, our hula dancers will bring the beauty of the beautiful island of Hawaii to share with you our hula ohana. There's two types of hula in Hawaii, hula kahiko and the hula ohana. This is the hula ohana. Ladies and gentlemen, our hula dancers. Just like we're professional. Sound. Play the sound, please.
Turn in robes of white, the blade. blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will.
Open another hands for our hula dancers. Share with you the spirit of aloha. Don't forget, wherever you go, continue to share the aloha with everybody. Now you know the meaning. It means the breath of life. So it's called release life to one another. Amen? Come on. Can I hear amen? Amen. All right. Put your fist in the air like this. Everybody, put your fist. Release your thumb, your little pinky. Shake it. It means hang loose in the island of Hawaii. When you go to Hawaii, you see the logo standing on the beach and say, shaka. Everybody say, shaka. Yeah, shaka man means sit back, relax, and enjoy. All right. Team Extreme, we're going to bring our warriors. This is a bit different as well. We're going to bend some metal bars with our teeth, ripping phone books. I'm going to introduce the team. We have the big fella here, Turaki. Turaki, all the way from Puka Puka, the Cook Island. And we have the High Chief, Farisa Louis, all the way from Samoa. And my name is Andy McFarlane from the village of Taungamanono. All right, we're going to start with the metal parts. So our warriors are going to bend these parts. And the story with these parts, you know, as I shared with the Samoan church this morning, to invite them to all the youth. Come on, youth, put your hand up. I invite them to come to the youth. They're sitting at the back there to the youth rally. And I share about the Bible speaking about metal. They sharpen metal, you know. If a banana farm, this you a mayor, this you a mayor. You know, it's time for us young people to rise up and challenge. Oh, I'm scared. Come on. And encourage one another. It's time for us to encourage. It's not about this is my church, that's your church. No, it's time for the body of Christ to come together. Because we see things are happening in the world right now, all over Australia. You know where I stay? People steal cars right in front of my house. You know, I'm really scared. I'm from Harvey Bay. I start driving down Street Ferry this morning. See how special you are. I drive all the way down here. All right, this guy's going to bend this metal bar. Make some noise. Come on, people. Come on. Make some noise. Come on, Marissa. Come on, Tooks.
Where my islanders? Tooks. Can some of y'all run down here to
Tooks
the front
from
real quick?
The Cook
I gotta
Island.
Know
Tooks.
Who's in the field and where my islanders?
Oh, yes.
I need y'all to run Woo! Down here. Come on, let me see ya.
Okay. This guy's got the youth. We believe that we come from heaven. And you know that most of our time, we got keep going straight through. We need to turn back and go back where our car bring create us. So that's a you. Okay, let's make some peace. Oh, come on, let's make some noise, everybody. Come on.
I trust, say it.
Oh, yeah. Be a fisherman. Beautiful fish. All right. This guy's gonna make a donut. Come on, I wanna eat a donut. Make some donut. Come on, make some noise. Come on, they need your help. Come on,
come on.
Too much fun, okay, guys. Everywhere we go, we challenge people not to try to do what we do. We've done a lot of training. Our show goes for an hour and a half with flip cars, breaking bricks. And it's always a message to go with it. But tonight, we just do a little bit of what we can. So these guys, those metal bars there represent the hard life that we live. When your parents tell you what to do and you don't listen, you need to break it tonight in the name of Jesus. Very soon. First. Yeah, that's what it's for life. All right, fry pan, don't do this at home. Leave the mama's fry pan for the eggs. Come on, guys, let's cook some eggs tonight. Make some noise, people!
Y'all got your part over here.
Come on.
I can't hear you. Come on, say it. Say it.
Roll it up. Roll it up.
I believe, say it. Come on. You are the God of miracles.
Oh, yes. Took all the way from the Cook Island. Oh, that's a new one. From the beautiful island of Samoa. Look at that. Are you having fun tonight? Yes. Guys, we love you. And we're here tonight just to share with you the how God brought this message, this tool to us to deliver the message. Most of the time, Christian can't go into prison. Prison can't go to the desert. But we can because of what we do. They want to see the phone book. They want to see. At the same time, we tell our story. Tonight, because when you do something extreme, what people do? They open their mouth and all the flies. Nah, just kidding. All right, we have the telephone book. Make some noise for Faressa. This phone book here, everywhere we go, we thank Telstra for sponsoring us, supply phone books. And this phone book here represents the book of hell. The scripture says, make sure our name has been written in the book of life. And that's our challenge tonight. Because this phone book here represents the evil book. Make sure your name is not in here. And tonight we're going to rip it in the name of Jesus. Our warriors were ripping in half. And that's a challenge. I was reading the scripture this week, reminding me that I had to make sure my name has been written in the book of life. Because if our name is not in the book of life, what happened? It will cut and throw in the fire. So you don't want to go in that fire. You want to go to the holy fire, not that fire. All right, make some noise for our warriors.
Just one more time in the balcony, everybody say it, say it.
So long,
bye-bye. Come on, make some noise.
So long, hey, so long, yeah, so long, hey, so long, yeah.
For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. Jesus gave his son. God gave his son Jesus to die because he loves you. He loves me. And that's the word. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. We're going to blow the hot water bottle. Not me. One of these guys is going to blow. The book of Revelation, it represents the power of God. And my challenge tonight, young people, I'm speaking about young people, make sure your life is right with God. I'm saying that, you know, I've been all over the world and all over Australia, where the Aboriginals, God take me to all the places to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. The hot water bottle represents power. There's power in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. People walk, people heal in the name of Jesus. We have to believe that God Almighty is a powerful God. Make some noise tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Farisa. All right, come on, Farisa, need your help. Make some noise. And this is our last end. Make some noise, come on, people.
Let's go, come on.
Coming down.
I believe you.
I trust
come on. In you.
Make some noise, people. Over come on.
Y'all got your part over here.
Over
I can't hear you. Come on, say it.
I believe, say it. Make some noise,
you
people.
You are the God of me.
Come on, you be said nice. Primary school is louder than you. Make some noise!
I believe, say it.
I believe.
It's getting bigger. Make some noise, people!
Come on, in the name of Jesus.
Hey, in the name of Jesus.
I see you back there, balcony. Y'all gotta come on.
Hey, come on. Make some noise, people. Come on. Come on. Make some noise, people. Come on.
So long, bye-bye.
Hey, in the name of Jesus.
So long, bye-bye.
Come on, hey.
I said to my brother at the back, did you take your medication before you come? Thank you for the opportunity. Five times, we'll have no. Here at all.
Turn to the person next to you. Very powerful. Amen. Please don't try this at home. Only me. And because I've got some muscles to do it. Amen. Hallelujah. Just kidding. Hallelujah. And our last item for tonight is prepared by my father's house from the north side. Amen. Let's give it up for our Northside youth as they make their way up on stage. To Avis Bati, Fafeloaya Tuai, Ilitato, Autalavo, my Northside, my father's house. Hallelujah.
Let's have a
Savage, Dolo Bachi, Evi Iaile Tua, Mole Itema Matango Fie, my Ile North Side, my father's house. So, and our first speaker for the night is Ruth Mamea from Samoa Revival Church. Let's give it a hand for Ruth Mamea as you make your way up on stage.
I'll be using two languages, Samoan, Male, Nganafa Bertania. So I'll be using two languages today. Aolo upfama losi, Omo Male, Luoti Motel, Fai Peono, Malevalu, Male, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 and 8, and Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8 today, yep. Ole melea, Ote famana tu watu yate oi. Ia toi whamumu le mea lofa mai I le atua. O le nei, awa e te mā I le muni mau, I lo tātou alii, po ona o au, o lo no no tia, ona o ia. In English, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 and 8. This is why I remind you to fan into flames the spiritual gift God gave you when I laid my hands on you. So never be ashamed to tell others about the Lord, or of me either. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then I said, here I am, send me. Ona ufa alonga tu waile le sifu fonga ole ali. O fape amai. O ai eo te awina atu. O ai foe alu atu mo I mato. Ona ufa apea tu wailea. Amen. The three main points that I will be stating today, o vaenga tolu eta uolo o mai nei tusi, vaenga mua mua, toi whamumu le mea lofa mai I le atua. The spiritual gift God gave you. Le vaenga luna lua, awa e te mā e moli mau I lo tātou alii. Never be ashamed to tell others about the Lord. Malevaenga muli muli, awina atuau, send me. The spiritual gift God gave you. Toi whamumu le mea lofa mai I le atua. What are some spiritual gifts? Oane me o mea lofa. La avatui whateita inga. Knowledge, increased faith, healings, the fear of the Lord. These are some of the things that God already given us, right? You have a gift, I have a gift. When we were born, remember that God already gave you a gift. You have a gift. Just remember that you need to fan into flames your gift. From the same chapter, verse 7, for God gave us not a spirit of fearfulness, but of love, power, and discipline. Alofa fa'ama losi maleusitai. So I ask you today that just remember the best gift that God has given us is Jesus. Oh my God. Thanks. Vae na longa lua. Awa e te mā e muni mau I lo tātou alii. Never ever be ashamed of your Lord or to tell others about the Lord. This is what Apostle Paul said to Timothy, his son. Awa e te mā. Fa mai paulo, awa e te mā fa pea o awa olo se te tono fa pui pui. Awa e te mā e te alu e tāu te ngata ia Yesu. So Apostle Paul told his son, don't be ashamed of your Lord. Go talk about him. Remember, when we go to church, that's when we only know God. We only know God on Sundays, right? But when you come out and then you go on the other days, oh, you just forget about him. So I want you to start thinking more about him every single day. You and I need to start thinking about him every day. And talk about him more. When you go to school, I want you to start talking about him to your friends, to your family, not only in church. We only
we need to go out there, talk about him. Never be ashamed. Malevaenga muli muli. Hawina atuau. Send me. This is what Isaiah said. Hawina atuau. Why did he say this? Okay. Isaiah was one of the people with unclean lips. Tangata ngutu leanga. He was a sinner, just like us. He was a sinner, just like us. So, Isaiah saw God in church. He saw him on his throne with two angels right there. He saw him, and he was like, oh God, I know I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. But then he stood there. He thought to himself, but then he saw one of his angels came down. He's like, he held this coal towards his lips. And then he said, all your sins have been forgiven. O papa yatu le neme yo longutu, o ave ise ina ai, lo amio leanga, mfa amanga lo inai foi, yau angasala. So Isaiah, all his sins have been forgiven. But then he said, Awina atuau, send me. He wanted to be the one. So he wanted to be the one to go preach the word of God. So he said, send me, Lord, I want to be the one. So we should be like him as well. We should be like Paul, the one that went out to other churches, spoke the word of God. We should be more like him. Don't be ashamed. We shouldn't be ashamed of him. So I want to ask you and me, how many times have God whispered to you? How many times have he whispered to you that you should go out more? Talk about me. How many times? Just remember that we should be never be ashamed of him. So I want you to stand up, talk to your friend about God, and spread his word.
But what a powerful speaker, amen. Very encouraging, very challenging, amen. Send me, turn to your neighbor. Are you going to be sent out? For maia tala Yeshu. If peyona awina maya uel tama, o te awina tu oto. Amen. As the Father sent me, I will send you. Amen. Hallelujah. Ole fim nga or kako. Combine. Send me. Are you willing to be sent out? Amen. Hallelujah. Tu vatashi o au toi fa feidoai il tato speak alona lua. Amen. My Victory Church o yale le afa penana mai ai. Le fe au mo tato il nei tu la le aso. Amen. Hallelujah. Is the speaker from Victory House? Ready to come? Victory Church. Hallelujah. I'm going to fata sheo. I've spati fafe loa ya to loa ya Catherine Schuster, my divine ministry. Hallelujah. Fape na ona. So my ya mola na saunuanga ili neitu la le fiafi. Let's give it one more time for Catherine Schuster from the north side. Oh, sorry, from the divine ministries.
By his goodness, his grace, his love, and his mercy. Second of all, I would like to acknowledge all our leaders, our pastors that are here tonight for carrying out that responsibility, for leading and obeying God, just obeying God. And just obeying his love and his will and his calling in your lives, because it's not an easy responsibility. Can I get amen, pastors? Yeah, so my hats are off to you guys. Hi, my name is Catherine. You can call me Kat. I am from Divine Ministries, serving under the leaderships of our great senior pastors, Oti, and his first lady, Trish Oti, who is also the young adults leader alongside with Pastor Collie. Oh, okay, forgive me, I'm so nervous. I'm humbled and blessed because if you would have asked me 2 years ago if I would be up here sharing my testimony, I would laugh at your face. but you know, God's plan, you never know it. You never know it. So I'm honored and humbled to stand before all you, especially our young people. Especially our young people, because this generation, we need to arise, to rise up. So the testimony that I'm going to share with you today is something very, very... Sorry, I got my tissues in my pocket, so it's fine. It's very, what you call, a very defining moment for me. And something that I don't like to advertise or share. But I believe God, because God has a way and a purpose for his using me as a mouthpiece today. And if I can encourage someone here tonight, just one person, then I've done my job. All glory to God, all praise to him, because it's not my glory, it's not man's glory, it is God's glory. And that should always go back to God. Amen? Are we awake? Okay. Okay. So, I'm going to get into my testimony. I was 18 years old, and yes, I look young. No. I was 18 years old when I decided to give my life to Jesus. What I kind of like truly understood the meaning of giving my life to Jesus. So, as you do as someone that gives your life, I also had my first encounter with the Holy Spirit. And have you guys ever encountered the Holy Spirit? Yeah. Wait, we should be happy if we have encountered the Holy Spirit. Have you guys encountered the Holy Spirit yet? Yeah, it's such a great feeling, right? It's like a sign sealed with your relationship with God. So I had that. I had my first encounter with the Holy Spirit. But that didn't go to plan. As life does, I was 18, graduated out of high school, trying to find myself, trying to find my place in the world, getting the pressure from my family, getting a job. And if you're a Pacific Islander, you know, right? Once you're out of high school, go look for a job. So I was in that position. But the most important thing was I was yearning for God. But hey, you think, oh, that's the start of my relationship with God, right? Hold on. So only my family know this about me. I'm not too sure if my DM family have heard about it. My journey with God has not been smooth. And if you had a perfect journey with God, when you're walking, amen? Yeah. Or no, it's not an easy journey when you're walking with God. So it had its challenges. And like I said, from navigating my life after high school, finding yourself, what you want to do, the pressure from finding a job, essentially what I just said, and everything else you go as a young adult. There is a lot of things in my life, and I'm pretty sure you guys too, that you can testify, but there's this one thing, and bear with me, it's going to be a touchy subject for some, but God has his way, and God's plan knows better. So for me, 18 years old, I wasn't a gutter person. Like, you know, I wasn't all about that clubbing life, the drinking life, and that came down later down the track. Mine was, I was introduced to a church. Now, who remembers that I said that I was also at the very pivotal moment with God? I was yearning for God. So I was introduced to this church. So this church that I was introduced to, some of you guys may have heard it. It was called World Mission Society, Church of God. Has anyone heard that church? No? That's all right. It was kind of like similar to our beliefs, but totally different. People viewed it as a cult-like church. But at that time, I was very vulnerable, very like open, and just wanted to get more of God. And everything that they told me, they teached me, sounded so right for someone that was so hungry for the word of God. So, but at the same time, I was facing my own battles with everything, like what I said. So this in church that I was introduced to affected my relationship with my family, affected my walk with my family to the point we didn't speak, to the point they just left me and let me do it on my own. But the one thing that I was drawing closer to this church was that they offered something that I wanted, which was love, which was family, which was, I don't know, just like someone that would just catch you. And you know, being in a Pacific Islander family, all these things is hard to get, right? All these things from your people, from your family, from your parents, from your brothers, from your sister. So that was me. So long story short, this was in 2012, guys. It was a long time for me. And my family all thought that I was too far gone. They gave up on me, just let me do my own thing because I was so adamant, and yet I was so blinded. So, but the story is how God redeemed me, God reconciled me back to where I'm at today. Can I get an amen? If God has redeemed you and reconciled you, can I get an amen? Yes. So that's why I said, if you asked me 2 years ago if I would be here, yeah, I would laugh at you. But during this time, my relationship with my family, like I said, was not in good terms. I was sent to New Zealand, and you know, when you're naughty, your parents just send you everywhere where there's family, Samoa, New Zealand, wherever they can, just to get rid of you. That was me. And then just all that jazz, because of the choice that I made. Because the choice that I made. Let me just say it again. Because the choice that I made. Because I thought it was for my good. Because I was leaning to my own understanding. And what do we know as a fundamental with Christians? Lean not only on your understanding, but the understanding of God. And I did it. So I left, like, I did it on my own. There was I'm also sick too, by the way, sorry. I was also, like, as much as you can paint a perfect picture, no matter what religion, no matter what beliefs, there's always a crack that will come through. And that crack shown in this church. Everything was more like a works-based faith. So it was kind of like working for your salvation. But do we work for our salvation with Jesus? Yeah. And I didn't know at the time. But then once I came to understand, I was like, oh my gosh, this is not where I want to be. But God didn't show it to me like that. He showed it to me in another way. And that was through my family. And God knows that my family and my heart, I love them, even though they cause me so much pain. I yell at them and, like, you know, lose patience and just like, why are you like this? But yeah, so God showed me through my family. There were many incidents that I went through, and one of them was my breaking point. If everyone knows, I am the sister of Pastor Ray that's here, the good-looking one. So he got married. He was preparing for his wedding, and I'm actually crying for tears of gratefulness, guys. He got married, but I didn't go to that wedding. Now, Ray's the first person in our family that got married. So it was a big deal for us. And at that time, like I said, my relationship with him was not good. My family, like, we were on speaking term, but only civil speaking term. And so something happened that really shook me and my family to the point where people are like, oh, did you go to Ray's wedding? And I'm like, oh, I was in there. Like, such an awkward topic. But this is it. This is what happened. And during that time, it was like God was taking me out of that situation to really open my eyes, to really open my eyes to the way that I was living, to the way that I was relying on his strength, on my own strength, to the way that I was like so cold-hearted. I had so much bitterness in me, hate, so much unforgiving trauma that was not healed, built over the years. And that time, at the time, it was not rainbow and sunshine. I was literally crying every day. But through that time, that season of redefinement, God showed me how to be redeemed. God showed me how to reconcile. Now, I'm sharing because there are many young people. There are many young people in this generation. There are many people that try and preach a gospel that's not other than Jesus. So they come for our young ones. Because why? We are gullible. One, if it sounds good to you, you'll take it. One, if you like, another one is that, oh, it sounds good, like this is the right thing. But that's not it, guys. We need to know God to be able to discern who God is so that we do not fall. And I was one of them that didn't know at the time. So if I can save someone that will encounter that, will go through that, will experience that, then I've done my role. I've done my duty. God is using me here today to testify and show about his goodness, his grace. But through this, he showed me redemption, reconciliation. Through my hardships, the battles that I was facing with my family, he showed me. And then slowly and slowly, he healed me. He healed my relationship with my family. He healed my relationship with myself. He healed my relationship with God in general. And that was the goal. He reconciled me not only to my family, but to God himself, to Jesus Christ. And I tell you, it's been how many years? Like probably 2 years since I've come back to church. And that's all glory to God. All glory to God. Because he showed me, and he showed me the real value of the salvation that he has given to us freely. Did he tell us to go die on the cross? Did Jesus tell us that you go take it? No, who did? Who paid that penalty? Sorry, who? Yeah, Jesus paid that penalty. So once we realize the value of the salvation that God has given us, we can come to discern the different, like, things that comes our way. And this is what I wanted to share tonight. I stand here in front of you all by the grace of God, by the grace of God, our Lord Jesus Christ. I have accepted our Lord Jesus as a Savior. And again, and no matter how many times that I fell, I feel like this is different. And it's time, young people, to rise up and take the baton. Because this is the next generation that is to take on the baton from our pastors, from our leaders. And if no one wants to stand up, then we might as well just all go sleep, right? No, because the gospel of God is alive. And we need to be the ones who have a willing heart to surrender, to give it all to God, to say, God, take it. Not me, but use me as your glory. And I just want to leave a verse that will tie into the theme tonight, send me. It is the Great Commission. So as all of you guys know, it's Matthew 28, verse 18. I'll read it out for you guys. So Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. He said, teach them Teach these new disciples to obey the commands I have given to you, and be sure of this, I am always with you, even to the end of the age. Three points I'm going to highlight, because it wasn't part of my testimony today, but God revealed it to me as I woke up today. So praise God. In the word it says, make disciples. So this is the major work that Jesus has given to us. It's to what? Make disciples. Second, these are disciples of Jesus. Jesus who are committed to him. And in turn, become what? Disciple makers. So once you become a disciple, you become the one to make the disciples. Second is, there was 4 points, sorry. Third is the goal of the Great Commission is to bring people to have a personal relationship with who? Yeah. Does it say a relationship with your parents? Does it say a relationship with your partner? Does it say a relationship with your brothers, your sisters, your friends? No. It says who? To bring people to have a relationship with? Yeah. With Jesus Christ, our Savior. And the last one is my favorite one, which is, what is the promise that Jesus promised us in this verse? It says, sorry, Pastor? Amen. That's it. Is that he will never leave us, because he said, I am always with you. I am always with you. And what a better reassurance in this word for us people. Because if it was a friend asked me, I'll be with you always. But you know your friend is always 50-50. Not true, right? But whereas with God, he fulfills his promises. So once we realize the goal of God, the value of our salvation, he will take us to become disciples. And that's it, young people. We need to become the people that are willing to be disciples. Disciples for Christ. Disciples to say yes and to just walk in faith with God. Because Jesus said that he is always with us. To the end of the ages. He didn't say it until tomorrow. He said to the end of the... Yeah. So I'll leave that with you guys. I am thankful. I'm grateful and honored for this moment, this time. You know, whatever you're going through, young people, whatever you are struggling through, just know that there is a God that hears you. There's a God that is ready to just capture you and take you out of that dark place. Now, if my family thought I was too far gone, but look at where I am today. Where am I today? So if God can do it for me, he can definitely do it for you. All we need to do is believe that God will take you out. All we need to do is have a heart that is surrendered to him. And that way we can return to the glory that God has promised us, which is eternal heaven. Now, I hope that you guys all be blessed. My voice is going, and my family know that I love to talk. That's why my brother got me to write out my testimony. But, you know, may you guys be blessed, and just know that every hardship that you go through, God's got you. So God be the glory forever and ever. Amen.
So I'll hand over to our main speaker for the night. Amen. Tu fa tashu au ta tu fa feiloi le sungal fa fenga le sungal au na le tu. Welcome, Pastor Bruce. Amen.
Ko kiki ale au wina mai le pastor ngi. Yesterday at the sports, and I'm very grateful for those who were there. At the end of it, I got home and I dad said, the spirit of gout, which we're going to rebuke, and we need to rebuke that in the name of Jesus. But I know, you know, we just need to leave the devil alone, mate. Sometimes it's just self-inflicted. So anyway, it was good games, and I got home, and I was just in so much pain. And I, you know, and I just text our tech committee, all sorts. We need a plan B. You always need a plan B. And you know very well that when you fail to, you know, when you fail to plan, and I don't know the rest of that, but you know what I mean, that we needed a plan B in case I couldn't make it here tonight. And so my TIK Usos just said, look, the plan A, B, and C is that we're just going to pray. That's what Pastor P was. Pastor Pete said that. Pastor Pat said that. And, you know, obviously, that it's an indication that God hears these guys. I'm standing here right now, aren't I? So thank you for your prayers. And I also, you know, want to just say g'day and whatalofa to foi, but yeah, my malo tato alfia, our TIK community, is an honor to be here this afternoon. I'm just saying g'day on behalf of our senior pastors. I'm from Logan, Hosanna Logan City, and on behalf of Pastor Manuia and Ruta and all our family there. So I'm going to get straight into this word here. And our theme that Pastor Fall just remembered halfway through the program about send me. No, that's nothing about him. He was just filled with the Spirit with his butty balls. And that he, you know, in Tonga you say, when you feel my whana, mate, you leave your head at home and anything goes after that. So well done. And, you know, massive congratulations and, you know, thank you to Faith and Kat for sharing your testimonies. That was beautiful. Very powerful. Faith spoke in two languages, and I said, oh, two languages, eh? Well, I'm going to have to up it one. Ruth, sorry. What did I say? They're both in the Bible, mate. Doesn't matter. They're both Christian names. They're both blessed ladies. As long as you remember your name, that's important. Ruth, well, thank you for having faith in Jesus. Good on ya. I'm going to get into the message, and I'm going to be using, you know, our theme is Send Me, and I'm going to be using an acrostic poem just to, you know, explain the message tonight. And, you know, you guys are probably thinking, is there anything this guy can't do? Is he a poet as well? Well, it just happens to be. I mean, the last poem I wrote was when Nez was asking me out. And, you know, when you got some side hustles going, mate, you just... So anyway, I was dating Nez at the time, and when you're dating someone and you're drawn to them and you want to make sure that you take it home, you know, and really seal the deal, you have to do a bit of research. And so, you know, I did a bit of research, found out she was Tongan, found out she loved buffets, you know, so that's easy to please, mate, easy. The poem wasn't going to be a novel at all. It was. And so I thought, well, Nez, she's amazing. She's Tongan. And I, you know, went up to Nez and said, hey, I got this poem. And I need you to know that I don't write poems lightly. Not everybody gets a poem. You're the only one. You're the only person in this whole planet and the galaxy as well that I have written a poem for. And anyway, that poem was, because she's Tongan, I said, Nez, maniokes are yellow and ufis are brown. When you're looking at me, your heart falls to the ground. For those 17 years, I've been falling to the ground. You know, for the last 17 years, I've been falling to the ground. So anyway, let's get into this. Let's pray in case I backslide. You are amazing and wonderful, and the work that you are doing in the hearts of your people is powerful. And just as Ruth declared tonight, Lord, stir up the hearts of your young people. Thank you, Father, that there is a generation, just as you called Isaiah, looking. Who's going to go for us? Who shall we send? Father, I thank you that there is a community, there is a company of young people, Lord, that are willing to stand up tonight and say, send me, Lord. Thank you, Father, that your spirit dwells amongst us tonight. We dedicate tonight to you in your victorious and sovereign name, Jesus. Amen. I want to summon your attention to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, which is our key theme. And it says here, then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. In the time that Isaiah came into the scene, Israel was in pretty much a dark place. The moral decadence in that place was just filled with sin. And they were pretty much in a place that was destructive and required someone. And God was seeking this place, seeking over Israel. Is there someone in this place that I can use to deliver my message? O te mi nei nā wina mai ai I a Isaiah. O se te mi o rana matau tia lava nā ngasala I a Israel. O te mi nei na pongi sā ai lava I a amiong o tangata. Ia lewa whapea mai lea tua. O iai sesi e mawhai o na tato o wina. O iai sesi I le nei nuu e mawhai a. O na whapea tuai I a Isaiah. Waule nei. And I believe that, you know, even through our whole TIK communities and gathering, that this is the same thing. The world is in a place where it's filled with darkness. Your schools that you're in is influenced by the works and the assignments of the enemy. And I believe that God is also speaking and seeking for young people, young adults. Is there a young boy? Is there a young person that will rise up, that will stand up and say, here I am, Lord, send me. Turn to your neighbor and say, send it. Hey, you married ones, mate, don't do your eyes at each other and send it. I see you, Pastor Sue and Pastor Oti. This is a family show, mate. God is in this day and age that in the midst of what is going on, and you don't even have to look too far to see what is happening in your backyard. There is so much sin that is happening. The world is getting darker, but it requires the disciples. It requires those who Ruth was talking about when Paul said to Timothy, stir up that fire, stir up that gift. It requires our TIK community, our young people. You are the next generation. It requires you to be stirred up, to rise up, to stand up and say, here I am, Lord, send me. Come on. You know, but in the midst of, in conferences and spaces like this, it's always very easy for us to get excited and, and really to say, Lord, I'm pumped up, man. I'm ready. Come on, let me go. Open up those doors. I'm ready to trot, bruh. Come on. I'm ready to go. But the key to being ready for being sent out is being faithful with the small things. Amen. The key to going out and being sent out into those mission fields is being faithful with the little things. Luke 10:16 tells us that whoever is faithful with small things, more things will be given, entrusted with. So what's important is that the mission field that we need to start off with. And this message is very straight and simple, mate. It is original, Smith's original chips, just plain and simple. I ain't going to go deep and theological on you because it requires us to come to the foundations, the fundamentals, because I know that we're all excited to get sent out. But you, if you get sent out and you're not even fully prepared, you're just going to get went out. You know what I mean? You'll just get there and then, you know, yeah. Unlucky us. But God is saying that, you know, and what I feel in terms of this message being so practical is that before we even start putting our hands to get sent out, why don't you send yourself to wash the dishes? Why don't you? I'm talking about practicality stuff. Let's not try and get super spiritual here and say, Lord, send me. I'm ready to shake my tongue and speak in tongues. I'm ready to heal somebody. How about you go and heal your room? Heal your... Go and heal that lawn out there. The basics. We all want to be sent out to Zimbabwe and to, you know, Congo and whatever else. But how about just being sent to do the fails, the basic fails? Instead of mom having to wash up, how about you go and send yourself to the dishwasher and wash it? Parents, shout amen. Come on, young people, you need to send yourself to do your homework, to do your studies, not send yourself to school and end up at South Bank. Come on. Yeah. E kuria kwa lea onga ala ka alo mai lano ne, le vi. Your fathers are laughing because they did it before you. They pioneered the way for you. And that's why they're trying to tell you, son, I've been there, done that. Look at where I am. It's the practicality of being sent out. The fundamental, simple, plain and simple, mate. We ain't going into, you know, extra trees, cheese and all these extra flavors. Just keep it simple. Righto? All right. Like I said, I'm going to be using an acrostic poem of S-E-N-D. I had to think about that to make sure I spelled that right. And the S stands for, is it up there? Let's say it together. Surrender. And I'm not talking about surrender in rugby league when your dad tackles your mum or your mum tackles your dad. Then the kids have to come in and play the ref and surrender, mum, get off. That's not the surrender I'm talking about here. John 12:24. And let's all read so you're doing something productive with your life. Read together, nice and loud. My father, well, it's Nez's dad, but because Nez is here, I have to say he's my dad. You know, Pacifica culture. You don't, when you're introducing your parents to Palangis, even though that's your parents-in-law, you just say that's your dad. But anyway, that's a bit off course. My father, he's an agriculturalist. And anything that he plants, it grows. And so the first point I want to make here is surrender. And in the process of planting a seed in agriculture is that the seed must die. And it has to be planted. It has to be buried into the ground so that the process of growth can begin. Amen? And what I feel that God is saying that as this point in terms of surrender is that we need to die to what is to our selfish ways of doing things. If you want to be sent out by, you know, with whatever mission field that God is wanting to send you out in, you need to surrender. You have to release. You have to let go. The very hard thing about letting go is that because it means so much to you. You value things. And when you let it go, there is pain because of attachment, because of soul ties. But God is saying that I am looking for a generation that I want to send out. Now, if you're saying that you are ready to send out, it requires us to surrender, to let go, to allow God to do the work, to allow God to plant you deep so that process of growth can begin. Amen. I remember when Naz and I first started courting and whatnot, and this was a process that was very difficult. It got to a time where, you know, the relationship became very unhealthy in the sense that we were just so in love, you know, and mainly for me because it was like a heart attachment. Jesus was my everything. I gave my life and I was running after God. And then we received like this is becoming an idol. Nez has taken Jesus's place. And when I had to cut it, it hurt so much. There was so much pain because it meant like, if I cut it, Lord, I may not get it back. If I release it and surrender this relationship, God, I've already got plans. I've already envisaging what the future is going to look like. And God said, that's the problem. That is your plan. You need to surrender that because Nez has taken my place. And I believe that even in this, as young people, there are relationships that we're in that you need to surrender. You think it's good, you think it's for you, and you think it's from God, and it could be, but it's become an idol. It's become something that you're so consumed with. It becomes something that takes up all of your time and your mind, and you wake up and you can't sleep because this person in your mind is so much ingrained. Now, for me, it was relationships. And I believe that God is also speaking to us about letting go of anger, of unforgiveness. All these, you know, elements here that I'm talking about, it requires us to surrender. If you want to, you know, the minute you surrender, that healing process can begin. The work of the Holy Spirit can come through, releasing even addictions, pornography, you know, all these things. I'm speaking up in your grill because I know it's something that young people go through. You know, all this, it needs to be released. It needs to surrender. And if we're putting up our hand and saying, Lord, send me out, these very things that is happening in our lives needs to be let go. The lust, the desires, all this of anger. So it needs to be surrendered unto God if you need to be, if you really want to be sent out. Amen. We're not just talking stuff that you can just do whatever you want and still be sent out. It doesn't work that way. Sooner or later, it will catch up with you. Amen. And if you're feeling like your Christian life is still in the same place that it was when you gave your life, you need to really look into what is going on. What is something that I'm holding on to that I need to let go? That I need to let go of. There is abundance and a harvest that God is wanting to bring. But that harvest ain't going to come if we're still holding on to things and we're not ready to let go. We have to surrender it. So that's the S. The E is equipped to do God's will. The E is for equip. Let's read together in Hebrews 13:21. Mate, all I'm hearing is wah, 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 wah. Let's read nice and loud. Like you mean it. Here we go. Equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work us. Coming to Jesus doesn't mean that you come to him empty. You know, when we say that when you come to the Lord, you come empty. It doesn't necessarily mean that we come with an empty head. You know, education is a key to the mission field. Education is so key for us young people, young adults, in order for God to use you out in the mission field. You need to have that education behind you. There needs to be a desire to hunger after learning. You know, I loved school, but education, which meant learning, just wasn't my cup of tea. You know, which resulted to me not being the sharpest tool in the shed. But education is so key in this sense in terms of preparation for the, for the mission field. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, Joseph, they were all teenagers. They were all your age. They're around the 14 to 17 year old. But these young men, they were positioned in influential government positions. And when you're in those spaces, you're able to bring influence. Some of us always think that it's only within the church that has, you know, that place of influence. And we're not all called to be in this space here. Some of us are, and if you are, get yourself qualified. But I know that God is speaking to a lot of us that you need to get yourself an education. Be faithful in school. Be faithful in those spaces of education. And we are very blessed to be in Australia, in a country that can provide us with spaces to learn. And I believe that, you know, as God continues to do a great work out in the mission field, and especially in your lives, education is very key. And, obviously Nez has gone through quite a bit, and I could keep mentioning that she's got a lot of degrees but doesn't know how to operate an oven and whatnot. But education is a furnace that has the ability to shape your mind, to train your mind. You know, when your mind is working, it hurts. That's because your brain is growing. It does work. It builds endurance. It builds that capacity to endure through the pain. And I want to say right now that it's very key for us, for you young people, in this day and age, and I don't even parents, value education. It is very important for us to be faithful, to pursue. There are spaces like where God called Daniel and Joseph and those many young men to be in those government spaces. I'm not saying that, I'm just using that as a point of reference. But the point is, those young men there just didn't get there because they didn't know anything. They got there because they studied. They got there because they took the time to learn. They took the time to study. They took the time to train themselves. And I believe that God is calling us young people here. There are spaces in government. There are spaces in the trade. You know, if you want to be a tradesman, there are all these opportunities. But those places is your mission field. Those spaces is where God is calling you. I need you there as a sparky. I need you there as a lawyer. I need you there as a landscaper, as a laborer. You're not just there by accident, but education will open up those doors. And great example is our pastors, our senior pastors and leaders who have been able to pursue. You know, these are their calling as pastors, and so they've gone to get themselves educated, pioneering the way, being that example. And I want to encourage each and every one of us, especially our young people. If you're really dropping, you know, when our daughter gets her report card, Nez and I are not too caught up in the grades. We always look for the effort. You know, what sort of, and that's very important. The grades will come if you put the hard work in. Amen. So if you're still in high school or still at uni, be faithful in your study. God is training you up. He's training that endurance in you. Continue to burn that midnight oil. If you get tired, just push yourself. Education is key for where God wants to send you and opening up those windows of opportunities. Amen. The N is for naturally you. Psalms 139:14. Thank you, Pastor Frank. Let's read together. 1, 2. One key thing about being sent out is that you need to be yourself. There's only one of you. Amen. There is no one else like you. And you need to understand that David said in that last part, there was so much confidence that David had that he knew who he was. He knew who God made him. He made him to be wonderful. And you know what? When you're in this space and getting to get sent out, when you're too busy to become somebody else, you compromise who God has created you to be. He's created you to be in his image and in his likeness. That is wonderful. That is marvelous in itself. We can't get caught up in comparing ourselves to other people and where they're at. That's their own journey. What about you? What are you doing about your own journey? But God is building and raising up an army, a generation of young people in this time that will just be themselves. God just wants to use you. Michael, you know, Ruth, not anybody else, but just it's important for you to be the authentic you who God has called you to be. Amen. And I, you know, this was obviously a path that I also struggled with. And this was after marriage. I struggled with trying to find who I was and try to be, you know, God, who are you calling me to be? Who am I, man? Who is this kid from Inala and, you know, from the banks and ended up in Logan? Who is this kid? And so after marriage, I was going through a stage where I was trying to be all these different people. You know, I was, you know, when there were guys that were preaching or certain people will behave a certain way, I would try and mirror that. I'll be, you know, I was pretty much a chameleon, mate, trying to adapt, trying to be something that I wasn't. And then my wife pulled me up one night, and you know, it's not good when your wife pulls you up. And most of the time, my ears are closed when my wife pulls me up. But you know what? You know, when it hurts, it's true. And there's what said, mate, you know what? I've got to tell you something. One pet hate that I have about you is that you're busy trying to be something that you're not. And I'm like, what's going on with you, mate? You know, where'd that come from? Goes, Bruce, you need to settle down. You need to accept who God has called you to be. You need to find yourself. Because as a husband, as the priest of this family, it's a bit hard to follow when you're all over the place, mate. It's a bit hard to follow a leadership when you don't even know who you are. I didn't marry Tom, Dick, and Harry. I married you. I need you to be who God has called you to be. And it's a lot, and it's quite hard because obviously coming through journey of culture and whatnot. But it wasn't until I actually accepted and really came to be who, and, you know, accepting who God called me to be, that I was able to fully walk in his purpose. And parents, I got to speak at you for a second here, because sometimes we can be Sauls trying to put armors on David. Amen. It's important for us to understand that your children, God has already a plan for them. There is characters inside of them. When we try and put the armor, when we try to put our own ideas of who we think they should be, it will never work out. That young kid becomes confused and they, you know, whatever, they probably just express it through anger and whatnot. But parents, we need to allow God to, you know, to do what he needs to do in our young people. Because David said that this armor just doesn't work for me. And so it's very important in this season of being sent out, and a key to being sent out is for you to be you. And if you don't know who you are right now, that's okay. It's a journey. But get in place and start, you know, seeking God, seeking him to find out your identity and who you are. And so you're not getting lost trying to be something that you're not. And the last one, and if I can ask, I'm going to land the plane with this, and I'll ask our praise and worship team to come up. The last key here is devotion. D is for devotion. In John 15:5, if we can read that one together. The This is the most important key of all these keys of sending. Because when we abide in Christ, when we dedicate and devote ourselves to Jesus, we can automatically surrender ourselves to Him. When we abide in Jesus, He is able to equip us. When we abide in Jesus, the naturalness and our identity comes out of that. So our young people, and I love what some of our young speakers hear, that God is not just for Sunday. There needs to be a season where we need to be authentic and true and having that devotion with God. You know, as we continue to struggle through just life as a young person, being a young person in this day and age is very different from when we were young. I do see it. Working with young people, you are faced with many more challenges, many more barriers, and things that you got to work out, but you can't do that on your own. It requires devotion. It requires you to abide in Jesus. When you abide in Him, He is able to give you the plan. He is able to renew your strength. And despite you running, despite you journeying, that the Bible in Isaiah tells us that although you may walk, you will not faint. Because when you come and wait on the Lord and not wait on other things or wait on your mates and what that, it's important for us to abide in Jesus. Amen. This is key. This will be the key to sum up the whole sending me. So I know that in our hearts, or you may not be really fully interested in this, but one day you will wake up and say, Lord, I'm ready to be sent out. It requires us to abide in Him, to be in Him. And He says that if I abide in you and you abide in me, you will bear much fruit. Without me, you can't do nothing. I know some of us here are quite smart, we're intelligent, we're quite skillful. But those skills in the natural and that intelligence that you have will only get you so far. It will never take you into the fullness of what God has called you to walk into unless you abide in Him. And even as Christians, we see this a lot. Even as Christians, when we come to church, man, we've got the craziest moves to praise the Lord. We're listening and we can't, you know, we just love Jesus on Sunday. But from Monday to Saturday, there is just no relationship. There is no devotion. All of that will start to show up. All of that will start to become transparent as you live your life. But it's so key to have that devotion, young people. If you want to walk into the fullness of what God has for you as He equips you. And as I said, this word and the whole theme, it is a prophetic word. It's an apostolic word. It is a word that sends out. It brings God's authority into your life and His power. But it requires this generation to say, Lord, yep, I'm saying here I am, but there are things that I need to sort out. There are things in my backyard that I need to really come before you and have that devotion to sort out what is going on. And it starts at home. Amen. So I'm going to, if I can just ask us to be upstanding. As we get into a time of ministry, as we get into this time of ministry, God is already, as David said, you fearfully and wonderfully made me. And Jeremiah said, before you formed me in my mother's womb, you knew me. Every young person in this space, every young adult, God already knows you. He already has a plan for your life. And each and every one of you will be sent out at one stage of your life. But in this time, while you wait for that calling of God to come in your life, let's continue to work through faithfully the first mission field, which is at home. Amen. Let's continue to surrender. Let's continue to, if you've some of you, if you've probably started studying, or if you were at school or at uni and then you've just said, "Nah, this is not for me," trust me, if you started it, it is for you. You didn't just get there by accident. God, you didn't just haphazardly get into university. There is a reason why you're there. Finish it. Get back in there. I'm declaring and I'm just charging you right now. Keep pushing. Keep going. There's a calling and purpose over your life. Surrender unto Him. God is doing an equipping. And don't be looking at anybody else to try and be them. God is just interested in you because He uniquely created you. Thank you. Father, we thank you for your word tonight. We thank you that there is a generation of young people in this space who are ready to get ready, who are ready for the preparation of your Holy Spirit, who are ready to surrender, who are ready to be equipped, who are ready to say, "Here I am, Lord, send me." We thank you for the work of your Holy Spirit amongst your young people tonight. Continue to have your way. Father, I thank you that there is a stirring in the hearts of our young people to pursue after you, to devote their heart to you, to devote their life to you, to devote all they have to you tonight. If there is something that you need to take away from tonight, young people, I want you to, devotion is the key. Devoting your life to Christ. Father, we thank you that there is a group of young people tonight that you love, that you have created fearfully and wonderfully. Wonderful are your works in their life. We bless them tonight. We bless them tonight. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. If there is a young person right next to you, I want you to put your hands on them right now. I want you to put your hands on them right now and just start praying and just start praying right now and allow the Holy Spirit to come and minister to that young person. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Holy Spirit. Flow in this place. Flow in this place, Holy Spirit. Those that may have been lost, those who are struggling to let go, those who are struggling to surrender, I decree in the name of Jesus, surrender. Release, release in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Our team's just going to minister a song, and we'll go into a time of ministry.
I'm going to show you my purpose. I'm going to show you my details. I'm calling you out through my word tonight to surrender, to get equipped, to be naturally you, and put your devotion. Put me first, says God, and I will put you first. You don't need to copy what's going on in the world. You don't need to copy what is not my culture. For I do have a culture. It's already spelled out in my word, says God. You follow my words and you watch. You will always come out the best and the top. I pick young Hebrew youth in the past, says God. I pick Daniel. And one day, he purpose in his heart is going to walk with the culture of the day. And the Lord is saying, young people, I pray that you will purpose in your heart to put God first. Father, I thank you, Lord. I pray for these young people here standing here in the midst of a powerful immorality, sexual immorality, temptation that Joseph encountered. He decided, no, I shall never do this. And I pray over you, young people, today that you will have the strength to stand up and say no No, no way, no way. Alexia, Masha, Kitarara. May the spirit of no to ungodliness be upon you, come upon you right now in the name of Jesus. May the spirit of saying no stand up and say no to sin. Liko shandeka bisato koromosi kalalala. Yekorosia karara. Well, the Lord is saying, I'm going to strengthen you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to guard you. I'm going to be behind you. I'm going to stand there to help you say no to sin. I rebuke sin in Jesus' name. Strengthen them, Lord. Strengthen, Lord. Lord, I pray, release them. Release them, Father God. Lord, that each one of them, they have a church they're serving in. Lord, I pray that as after tonight, Lord God, they go home. I thank you, Lord God, for your word that starts in the home, starts at the kitchen, at the bedroom, outside. But Lord, they need to take it out to their schools, to their friends, to their sports, to their area of influence, young people. I pray, Holy Spirit, please go with them. Holy Spirit, encourage them, empower them. When they are standing, Lord, I pray. I really feel young people in our congregation here tonight that the Lord is saying, I'm going to be with you. I'm going to strengthen you to say no, and I'm going to give you boldness to stand up and speak the truth, and I'm going to give you wisdom, says God. I'm going to give you wisdom to say when to say and when not to say. Father God, I pray for all the pastors that are here, the fivefold ministers and the different churches, Lord God, that these people will be armies, will be at the front, Lord God, to be forerunners, Lord God, in their churches. Father God, many times, Lord God, that in today's world, that some of the young people don't have time to do things for you. They can go to church sometimes. But Lord God, I pray today, change their heart. Change their heart. Move in their hearts, oh Lord God. Young people, please raise your right hand up. Raise your hand. La Moshika da da da. I sing Jesus. Your name is power. Sing it. Your name is healing. Your name is love. I just sing the name of Jesus. I through the dark. Your light. I just want, and you sing the verse, I just want this. Sing the name of Jesus. I just want. Come on, team, sing. You got a better voice. Young people, just raise your hand. That is your stand tonight. I just want to speak.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Till every dark addiction. I come against every addiction, young people. In the name of Jesus, be clean. Name is power. Name is healing.
Your name is power.
Your name is healing.
Your name is love.
Break every stronghold.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows.
Some final words, young people, youth, young adults, young couples. Can you all look at me? Hi. Hello. You know what? When you go home, when you go to church next week, go and tell your pastor, "Pastor, what do you want me to do?" You hear that? Just say it. Pastor, say it. Pastor, what do you want me to do? I will do it. Say again, Pastor, you are cool. And last one, Pastor, what's for lunch, bro? You may go to your seat. Thank you. We almost finished. I just have my part. Can I do my part here? We have a group, Sandy and Taito. It's a group going for a mission. What a beautiful planning of really big thank you. Let's give a hand for our organizing team. Are they here, Sandy and Taito, and the mission team going to somewhere? Are you here? Oh, there, come. I'd like to pray for you. Are you part of that group? Yeah, come here. We're going to pray. You know what? As they come, because they're very shy, I thank God for the YWAM, the group that, thank you, Andy, and your group. It's so amazing how this whole connection, we started this ministry with Samoa for Mission, and was the main focus was outside, and we change and move on to a new version, which is the Tasia Kiriso. And we think it's just you going. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, there's a lot of them that are going for your mission work. I pray, Lord, as they depart, as they go, Lord, protect them, Lord, equip them. Letua ia lato oatu letua e failau laufe au letua male mana. Lord, I pray when Moses went out, Lord God, he asked for your presence to go with them. Team, go with the presence of God. Go with power. Go and make a difference. Father, I pray release of your blessing over them. Equip them. Support, Lord God, and everything they need. Please provide for them, we pray. Bless the mission, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you. Our leader, Pastor Pippa, is not here. It's just his wife. She's like teary at the moment because, By the way, my wife, I'm wearing two rings at the moment. This is her ring. She lost a very beautiful bill that was like the bill of bill. And if you found a white thing, it's not part of the TIK announcements, but I appeal to you, brethren, that let's be of one heart. Yeah, because it cost me a lot of money. Anyway, thank you so much. So my talk is on behalf of Pastor Pippa, that is not here. I really thank God. Yeah. Mission Group, the worship center, they're calling for their mission, their conference. So may the Lord be with you, Pastor Moala, and the team, Malefalitua, Ia Mailato. Even our group, it's so beautiful. This morning we pray for our team, our group, and they say it to me, "Okay, so we go in and do we have our churches in Samoa?" I said, "Yes, we do. We have our church in Samoa called Worship Center, called Assembly of God." And when you go there, hey, God is bringing the church together. That's why I thank God for the body of Christ. We are one in Christ. And for those who are new and those who are visiting us today, just a quick update. We do have a vision and a mission for this organization to be one in Christ. Last month, at the time that Apostle Vidiamu passed away, we pray and all that. We got a call from New South Wales. There's another big group in New South Wales. They wanted to become one in Christ. And I said, we'll see how it goes after last Wednesday. We said, yeah, if you don't have the gift of interpretation, as you can see, I'm wearing blue just to cheer up those who support that team that lose all the time. Yeah, I might need to pray for all those who support the Blues. Yeah. By the way, if you live in Queensland, support your state. Yeah. Yeah, because this is your place of blessing. Position yourself to where. I know there's some blue that are not very happy with me. If you're not happy with me, it's just a game, eh? That was finished. We're just waiting for a clean sweep at the back so we can clean all the tables properly and ready for a cup of tea. Yeah. What else am I supposed to do, a secretary? Can you stand up, please? Can you please stand up? This is the best secretary in the whole wide world. Thank you so much, Ne'e. Because our boss said that I need to say all these things. And we thank God for that. So tonight, may the Lord bless you. Thank you for coming. And last and not least, beautiful preacher. Thank you so much. So beautiful. Yeah. Now give me back my notes when you finish. And we give thanks to God. So, Pastor Ne'e will come and take us to the next part. Is that the right plan? Or are we going to close? I think Fo needs to come and close this. He was doing all these moves up here. And I said to myself, man, come a choir to Stala. So, Pastor, yes, to my if I umalo tute, the tattoo of Yafi. Leo matu loa tu fo I leo langa sa e o lai fo I lava yaso. Lava I teimi. Awa te a me tuai wa fa fo e lea tua mea uma. God bless you. After this, we go and have our cup of tea at the back.
Up the maroons. La fahi uta tau ne fiafi, hallelujah. Le atua ya fo I lava levi inga ya te oelo mātou tama. Ya umana mātou faya le ne fiafi mātou te faa fo I levi inga, o le faa aftai, o le faa manu I la uofio. May your name be glorified in everything that we've done today, Lord. We give it all back to you, Lord. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Bless the food that we're about to receive, Lord, for the nourishment of our body. Bless your people, Lord, and have a blessed week, Lord, ahead of them. In Jesus' name, amen. Yep. Let's live.